She's just a girl and she's on fire. Hotter than a fantasy, lonely like a highway. She's living in a world and it's on fire.
Hi.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, can you hear? How are you?
I'm good. So tell people your name is.
My name is Jean. You can say Jean. And I'm a student in communication, and Rose agreed to have this little interview with me. So it's very nice from her. So thank you.
You're welcome. I like talking to I like making sure I connect with people and have conversations with people from like every age group, and not just, you know, I never understood why, honestly, people like with a verified check mark only talk to people with verified check marks.
Yeah, sure.
Because that seems like a really small bubble world. I would rather talk to someone who's got like 2,000 followers and or 43 followers and see what's up in their life, because their life is more interesting to me. And so you and I got to speak and to talk about your love of film and all of that, which is amazing. Yeah. So I guess let's go. Let's do our interview.
Okay. So we're gonna back in time before making a stop by Planet Nine. Does it sound good to you? Yeah. So in 2001, you arrived in a popular show called Charmed. And the context was Shannon's left and her beloved character Prue died. And so in this context, and in your opinion, what made the fans love Paige and not see you or her as Shannon's replacement?
Well, I think because I never considered the fact that I was Shannon's replacement, because I was a totally different character. Some TV shows in the past, they would just hire an actor to play the same character, and all of a sudden it's just a different actor, kind of like in a soap opera or a telenovela or something like that. But this is very much a different character. But I also knew that I had a lot of work to do to make people not hate me, you know, because they wanted to hate me from the very beginning, like, because they loved Prue. And they saw me, even though I had nothing to do with any of it, you know, as like, who is this coming on the scene? And so the way I wanted to create Paige as a character was just to kind of make her so lovable, so sweet, that just kind of goofy, but also have inner pain. You know, I kind of wanted to base her like, if I hadn't have had to be very hard and fight a lot in life, I'd probably be more like Paige. In a way, like, because that's very much like me, just kind of accident prone and goofy and sweet, but you know, I shoot fire also. I shoot fire, I shoot orbs, real life and fake life, so it prepared me well.
Yeah, and I think the fans, well, me, immediately loved her because, like you said, she was goofy and had such a painful past, moving past. And I think she was a fresh addition to the show, because and I think we needed it, because Charmed could have been quite redundant, you know, if it was 8 seasons were only about sister fighting demons. So I think we needed that story of loss. So yeah. And how did you feel the first time you saw that the show you were going to be involved in was about 3 women in power?
With women in power? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
So, like, how did I feel about joining a show that was about women with powers or women that were powerful? Is that the question?
Yeah.
So I would say, well, that's probably what attracted me, my attention to it, you know. I was doing a movie in Romania, and I got a call, and Aaron Spelling is the producer of Charmed, and he was a very famous, long-time producer of many TV series, many shows, many movies, you know, things like that. And so it was like Aaron Spelling on the phone for Rose McGowan, and I'm like, ha, 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 click. I turned it off. I just thought, I was like, someone's calling pretending to be Aaron Spelling. How funny. And it turned out it really was him. And they said, would you like to come meet on this role? And I had never seen the show. I'd been working so much. And a lot of my movies, I filmed at night. So I didn't really like have kind of the same amount of awareness of what was going on in society. So I wasn't really even aware of Charmed. And then I got on the plane to go from Romania to Los Angeles to meet Aaron Spelling. And on the plane, the choices of what to watch was the pilot season, pilot episode of Charmed.
Yeah.
With all three of the original girls. And so I watched that and I was like, oh, yeah, I can do this. And that's kind of how that happened. And I didn't think about it as, you know, I've always felt quite powerful in myself. So I was just like, you know, who doesn't want superpowers and to throw things around?
Yeah. And years later, you released, I'm making a jump in the future, you released your book, Brave. I have here it. It's in French, but I'm planning to order it in English, the original version. So yeah, anyways, in which you're telling your life from one cult to another, which is Hollywood. And I wonder what gave you the strength to stay and pursue your career, even your career when inside you were boiling.
Yeah, what was the connection? So you're saying inside I was feeling a certain way, but outside people saw my career a different way?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, that was really hard. And I think it's just also like, imagine if you went to work every day, but everything that came out of your mouth wasn't something you thought of to say yourself. So that, and that can be fun, but it can also be like, okay, today I just want to be myself, but you can't. So it was just hard for me because it was like layers and layers of getting your voice taken away or just never coming out. And so I just had to kind of fight my way back to being like, no, this is my voice. And for me, it was kind of like, okay, society has had a lot of thoughts for me and I have some thoughts for them, but my thoughts, I think I only try to come and help people because why not? You know, why not help?
Yeah, and were you, you know, when Brave was released, were you kind of afraid about of consequences or in the contrary, relieved?
No, you see, I had been dealing with monsters. When you guys all heard about the news, when it kind of exploded in the world, like 3 years ago now, it was already going on in my life, the craziness behind the scenes for like 3 years when I was writing the book. And it was like so extreme. And I was in such a world of like bad guys everywhere and I didn't know, or and women, and I didn't know who was good and who was bad and what the hell was going on and trying to put out this book. I knew what I was doing was going to cause a culture reset because that's what I wanted it to do.
Yeah.
And so I knew it was going to be hard and I knew it was going to be brutal and it was. But yeah. I also knew if I could only survive, if I could just get through the other side alive with my mind somewhat together, then, you know, that would be a rare thing because usually people, when they come out against power so hard, they don't live. And they tried to make it, so I didn't.
Yeah, and you received a lot of aids. Like I think 3 days ago, you did a live, and people joined, and he insulted you. I don't know if you remember.
Oh, the one with the crazy voice.
Yeah.
It was like Satan voice.
Yeah.
The dark. So,
yeah. How did you deal with negativity and hate in your life, like every day?
Well, you know, you guys saw what that was like from the outside, and you guys have your own experience with hate and negativity, and everyone has their own relationship with it. I'd been kind of having that same hate on me from the second I moved to America when I was 10, and it didn't let up. So it was kind of always the same, but just then bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. So how I deal with it is just like, you know, it makes it lonely, but I'm like, I know I'm right. I know that I'm not the crazy one. I know it's you. And just by knowing that it's not me that should be ashamed, and it's not me that should feel bad because other people don't like me. A lot of people get very upset when people don't like them. I'm like, I'll just add you to the long list. Doesn't really matter to me. Because there's also a lot of people that do like me, and there's people I like and there's people I don't like, you know. But I think people, you know, for you guys on the other side of this Instagram Live, yeah, you know, when you do say something mean to someone or something nasty, or it does hit the other person. There is a person it affects, you know, on this side. And so I would just, you know, ask people to remember that. And it's not that they have to say like, oh, I love you, but just, you know, the really mean stuff. There's just, and right now, because I mean, it's so hard right now for so many people, and the mental health problems going on and the fear, you know, we just, a little less hate would be a nice thing.
Yeah. And does maybe writing help you to get through this?
No. No, writing made it even more, like more people to hate you kind of thing. So it was kind of like turning the volume up on music, you know. It was like, come on, let's go. But like, I think, you know, a lot of girls and women from very small are taught to be polite, and they're taught to not make people, especially men, upset, most likely because they can all, you know, also like die or get killed by them. So it's to a little girl, like, you know, a man being angry at you and screaming at you is like, you try to do anything you can to avoid that. Because imagine, like, you know, when you're little and someone's yelling at you and how big they are. Well, to a woman, if you're not a very tall woman, that's kind of what it's like all the time anyway. You're still small and there's still someone big up against you, like, and I just kind of, it's almost like, you know, when you feel good, you're walking down the street and you put on headphones and you're like, all these people are just, and you're like, that's kind of how I try to live my life. I'm like, I'm going to put my own internal headphones on and just be like, and it doesn't make it fun, because you'd rather have people going, yay, than having people like throw things at you. Sure. But I am here to say to all of you out there, you can survive it. You can survive not being liked.
Yeah, and talking about music, today you're back with an album called Planet Nine. I think you were working on Brave and Planet Nine at the same time, no?
Yes.
And so you say that it's music to heal people, to free them. What is the purpose of this album when you first worked on it, and how did you perceive to achieve that goal?
How did I achieve that goal? Is that what you said?
How did you proceed to achieve that goal?
Okay, so yeah, I started Brave. I started writing my book Brave because they really go together. Like, the best way to get Planet Nine's ultimate experience is to kind of have read Brave first, because it kind of prepares you in a weird way for it, and it's kind of the reward. It's like, I knew what I was going through writing it was like making my brain hurt, and I knew I could make something really beautiful, and it's just kind of my gift, like, to people. Like, I wish I could do more to save the planet. I wish I could do more to take away people's pain, to do more to help, but this is what I can do right now. And it's something that I created, that I worked very, very hard on with some great collaborators, and I'm incredibly proud of Planet Nine. And it's a really special, it's different. It's not like me trying to be a pop star. It's just how I created it was just by following my instinct, my inside voice that said, this is what you need to do next. And I even had, like, one of my producers said, you need to do the vocal, the singing on this one song again, on Sirene. He said, we don't like it. You should do it again. And I said, no, this is my album. I like it. Sorry. I think I was right, because I like how it turned out. And whether I'm right or not, it's my project. So it's really important, as, you know, when, as younger people like you guys, like, when you're making a project that's an art project that's yours, make sure that it's really your voice, that you don't like think of like, oh, these people are older, they must know better or something like that. And it's very like, it's great to be like, no, this is, and sometimes, you know, other people's voices, it helps you unlock a problem that you haven't been able to solve. But if you know inside of your heart that what you're doing for you is the right thing, then I think that will translate to other people.
Yeah, and you say it was different. And I must say that I think I told you when I first listened to it, I listened to the first song and I was like, okay, I don't like it because it's not my kind of music. But, you know, I have anxiety, so I gave it a try because you said it was music to heal and you told me that you told to people that it was helping you with your anxiety. So I tried and it was very good. And I even felt asleep with it. It isn't a bad thing for me. It's a good thing. If I fell asleep with it, it's that it works. You know, it's, I mean, peace. So, yeah, because the problem with anxiety is our thought. If we listen to them, we're screwed. So to not listen to them, usually I put on the music as loud as possible. And recently it was Planet Nine that I put as loud as possible. So I probably healed the whole neighborhood here.
Bravo. Well, it's okay. Even if I know it's different kind of music than what some people like, but it's not really even kind of about the type. Like if I like these types of music and not that type of music, it's not really that type of music because it's really kind of in its own world. And I, for me, like I know like anxiety and trauma and bad dreams and the tightness, you know, when your stomach is so tight and it feels like your mind is going a million miles an hour, you know, it just helps like take that away. And it's kind of like natural medicine.
Yeah. And have you got a name for your music, for that kind of music?
For what it is?
Yeah.
I don't. Do you? I have not been able to figure it out. I'm like mind medicine. But it's better than that because you can get up and move your body to it if you want to. You know, I know you're in Germany, right?
No, I'm in Belgium.
Oh, you're in Belgium, sorry. But like that's more of like a German, Belgian, like, oh great, there's a drill. Oh great, great sound times right now. Can you hear that?
Yeah, a bit.
Sorry. Well, what are you gonna do? Maybe soul medicine. Soul medicine? It's just it's like an astral connection. It's spiritual. Okay, I'm reading. Somebody said, how about spiritual medicine?
Yeah.
That works.
Sounds
alien. I'm going to try to go inside my house because this is really annoying.
Okay.
So hold on. I might lose you. I hope I don't. Hi, Pearl. Okay, let's see. How does this work? Okay, everyone can see the kitchen behind me. It is hot. Woo, it's hot outside. Is that better?
Yeah. Are you living in Mexico since a long time?
I've been here for 2 months maybe now, but I've been coming to this area for a really long time.
Oh,
okay. Probably for since 20 years, longer than you're alive.
And you decided to move in just before quarantine?
No, I decided to move for quarantine because I had been in Norway giving a speech about 8 weeks ago, and I'd already been watching, because I don't watch American news. I like watching international news. I like The Intercept or Al Jazeera, something like that, something. So I knew, I just kind of was paying attention. I knew coronavirus was coming. It seemed longer than, I mean, I know there are people that knew it was coming too, but I just knew it was coming. And I was like, and my apartment was done in New York. My the lease where I had to keep paying was over, and it was like, because I think right now in America, I feel so bad for it, you know, because Donald Trump, even without coronavirus, there's so much toxic there that it's giving people, I feel like, stomach cancer. Hold on one second. And I just think it's a toxic environment, and I've kind of like had enough of it, you know. So I was lucky enough that I was like, this is where I should be. I just knew like where I needed to be. Excuse me. And I'm lucky because it's like less than half the price of you know where I was in New York. You get a lot more.
And you seem to have a very big house, so you're very lucky.
Well, it's like two bedrooms, but it's got two floors and it's really pretty. And I had a small apartment in New York because I wasn't there very much. Wasn't very big. And this is 50% less. But
my God,
because Mexico is just, it's not like European prices or American prices. It's very affordable.
Yeah. And before that you were in London.
Yeah, I love London. It's like the crossroads of the world. It's like everybody from everywhere eventually kind of goes to London.
Yeah.
So you can go there and you can meet somebody from Ethiopia. You can go there and meet somebody. And America has that too, but not, it's different there. This is much more like cosmopolitan and international, you know, kind of like, so it's very interesting. And it's just something that, like, I don't know, I lost my train of thought because sometimes I see what people write and then I'm like, oh, what about that? And then I forgot what I was saying. Okay, so continue.
I'm reading them too. Sometimes it's...
I know, we're reading them.
So, we were talking about Planet Nine. And in this album, there is a song called Rise, which is really interesting because it's the only song that we don't hear your voice. And just why have you incorporated a song without lyrics in your
album? Exactly that reason. Why I put no lyrics in Rise was because Rise, like, haven't you ever, like, you watched a movie and it has this music with no words, but it really gets you in that feeling and that emotion?
Yeah.
Right? I wanted that. But also, Rise comes after a song called Lonely House, or a track where it's 7.5 minutes of spoken word with this, like, incredible kind of, like, operatic space beat. But then after that, after a lot of words, the way I am, like, I'll be really honest, I have broken up with people if they talk too much, like I can't take it. I'm like too much in my head. So I thought, like, after a song like Lonely House, where it's a lot of speaking, that people would like a rest. I can't hear you, honey.
And I said a song which is really moving to Lonely House.
What about Lonely House?
No, I said you put Rise, after Lonely House, a song with a lot of words and also a song which is really powerful, moving, you know. So I think it was a pretty good idea. And I agree with you about a song which is only instrumental, because that way we can, you know, create our own
your
journey.
Own feelings. Yeah. It's also your own feelings, your own thoughts, your own emotions. I don't like my work. That's why I'm brave on the hard cover. You know, it's the back of my head on the cover of my book. And I did that because I thought they changed it for the paperback, which I hate. But the one with the back of my head, I wanted to, like, if I'm doing a book for people to think about things differently, why would you want to, like, see my stupid face on it? Like, you know, like, give people some privacy to have their own thought and emotion and their own feelings. It's not about me. It's I'd rather them just like get into the words and see what's up, you know, in their own. And same with Rise, with the music, with not putting words there. It's like, it's for people to create their own sound in their mind and their own vision and their own colors on their planet and how they feel like they can rise, you know what I mean? And not everything needs words. I think we use words too much a lot of the times.
Yeah, and we can create our own journey with a song like that. And well, it's one of my favorite, but really my really favorite is Green Gold, because I used to listen RM
486.
Yeah, sorry, but that was hard to say. I used to listen to that song Underwater. I don't know if you remember, and it's a bit strange, but it is so good, and I recommend to everyone to try and Underwater. You know, there is some phone case that you can put underwater, and so I was in the pool, and I put my phone in the pool, and so I was swimming. And,
oh, amazing!
The music. I sent you the video, but it was years ago. I think I still have it. If you want to,
I want to see it.
Yeah, I will send it to you. So yeah, it was. So when you said in your life yesterday that listening to your music, you have moved like you are underwater. I think about that. I thought about that. So yeah, I will send it to you.
Thank you. Well, RM486 was always the baby version of the song was going to grow, and it wasn't finished. It wasn't. RM486 was more to go with a video art project I collaborated with someone on. It wasn't. It was just kind of like be like to put people on notice. Yes, I'm doing music. But what was cool about it is like just the what art is so amazing is you don't know necessarily when it's done, and then at some point you have to be like, well, this is done. But when I heard Green Gold, RM486, so what happened is someone played a piano to RM486, and I heard it, and they made it slow, and it was so beautiful. And now I thought, I have the slow version and I have the fast version. And they were like telling me I had to choose. And I was like, what if I just turn it into one soundscape? Like, in so it starts with the piano Green Gold, former RM486. And then in the middle, it starts like, it's almost like the piano goes more and more and more, and then it goes into the fast electronic version. So it's still the same song because the second half of it hasn't been changed. It's just the middle and the first part. But I just thought it was a great and unique way to do it. And you know when like you think something is, you know when you like know something can help people and you just hope that it comes to them in a way? Like I just hope it finds people that, you know, it needs to find. I didn't release Planet Nine all of a sudden. Like, most people do 3 months of press, magazines, interviews, and it was only 2 weeks ago I said, I think people should have Planet Nine now. And so I'm trusting all of you out there to help me, to like spread the news that it is spiritual, mind, dance, peace, medicine. And even if you think, like you don't like this kind of music, it's not, you know, it's not really like, it's just different. And to give it a chance, because, and also maybe do a thing where you just give it to your friends and have them recommend it to people, because the way this is gonna work out is by you all spreading the word. Since I'm not doing it in a traditional way, a traditional release, I need all of your help. So thank you.
So you won't do any concerts with Planet Nine? Are you planning on something like, I don't know if it exists, but like some healing class, you know, with your music?
I am, but also, you know, Planet Nine also has visuals. If you go to rosemcgowan.com, there's a little preview of some of the visuals that I filmed all myself for Planet Nine. And what I'm gonna do is travel Planet Nine around in a dome, you know, like a planetarium, and people can lay on the ground, and it's gonna have the visuals, all the images all around them, and then the sound around them too. So it's gonna be a traveling art and spiritual experience where then I talk for a little bit afterwards or before, and we talk about Brave, and it's gonna be like a whole day or a half a day. Like probably start at like 3 p.m. and go till like 8 p.m. And then people but just have that feeling.
You are going to do this around the world or just?
Yeah, around the world.
Around the world, cool. So you're going to come in Europe.
But I'm not going to, I'll talk, but like why I don't wanna perform Planet Nine is just, and it's fun to sing along to. I just don't think electronic music really sounds good in life when you sing with it. Sometimes it does, but I just haven't found it yet. And for me, it's just, I really thought that I was interrupting my own work, and I didn't want people to stare at me, because I'd rather be sitting in the audience next to them and have the same kind of experience.
Yeah. Sure, and you did, before Planet Nine was released, you did some like concert in no?
I didn't perform that one. I did Fringe Festival in Scotland.
Yeah.
Which is a very big, the Fringe Festival is a very important cultural festival, the most attended one in the world, actually. Most people go to this, so that's crazy. And I did four days there. And that was cool. And that's how I learned that I didn't want to perform it. I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't done it. And I was like, no, not for me. And I love people that love performing live, and then I can watch and get that energy from them, and they have that kind of energy. This is not that album, and this album is more of an art piece. And I think art affects, you know, your mind, your soul, your body, and everything. So does music. So if one can approach making music as if you're making an art piece, you know, if I gave you my painting that I painted, I wouldn't have to come make the painting live alive for you. You would just have my painting. So that's the painting.
Thank
and
you.
People can do with it what they want.
Thank you. So
great.
I have no question left.
Okay, honey, you did a great job.
Thank you. I was a bit stressed, I have to confess.
Well, of course, this is scary. It's not normal.
Yeah, but I did 3 interviews before, but this one was a bit special to me, you know, because I grew up with you, so I was a bit rather nice. I read that some people said, boy, you're too stressed. And I was like, I know.
During talking to me? Yeah, it's hard. It's weird because you're not just talking to me, you're talking to quite a lot of people.
Yeah, that's it. That's all that was there. And I'm not used to it, and I'm like, ooh.
Yeah, I don't really think about how many people are like, will eventually see this, or, and it's kind of like my personal philosophy, like whether they're online or in real life, like what you think of me, whether it's good or bad, at the end of the day, it's actually not my business. Because if I walk into a room and people are all quiet all of a sudden, I could sit there and start thinking, oh God, they're all thinking horrible thoughts about me. And maybe they are, but you know what? Not my business. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's it. It was...
It's not my business. So like one of the ways you can approach this is just realizing like what other people are thinking of you, like watching you, is to spend my time on your side of it and just be like, it's not my business. I'm just going to do my best. And that's what you did.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Yeah, and I like that because, you know, I like to get over my stress, you know.
Me too.
Yeah, that's it. If I do that, then I will be better and better and better and better. So that's why I like it.
That's exactly. Every time you get through something that's scary or stressful that requires you to be brave, it gets you with more brave for the next time. Because you're like, I survived this. I can survive this. This is bigger. Okay, here we go. And then you get to the next big thing. you know, and you keep going that way and courage, you know. I was always very scared of heights. I don't like high. So I jumped out of a plane, and the plane goes up a lot higher than you would think. You're like, oh, I'm really, really high up now in the clouds. And then you're like, I'm just going to jump out, even though I've hated heights my whole life. But I resented, I was mad that I hated being scared of something, that something caused me fear has always made me quite upset. Like, I want to conquer this fear. So it kind of cured it. I jumped out of a plane. I never did it again. And I was like, nailed it. Cool. Not afraid of that. I still don't want to go stand on the edge of a building. But it's not a fear that's like coming after me anymore.
Yeah, sure. So thank you so much for this interview.
Thank you, Sean. Have a wonderful day, Siri.
You too. Could you save it so I can have it to put on my website?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sean. Everybody tell Sean he did a great job. And I know you were nervous and you grew. You did some, you know, same thing.
Sure.
Know you. Okay, honey. Bye.
Bye.